From coast to coast and around the world, it's time to praise the Lord. Praise the Lord covers the major Christian events in America and across the world, from the heart of Europe. To the tip of Africa. From the centers of Asia. To Central and South America. You're a part of the world's largest prayer and praise gathering. Joining us from New York City are best-selling author and relationship therapist, Dr. Ron Elmore, pastor and elder of Perfecting Faith Church, Lewis and Andrea Mellini, founders of God Glorified Music Incorporated, Kevin and Shondel Lavar, senior pastors of the Greater Allen AME Cathedral of New York, the Reverend Doctors Floyd H. and Elaine Flake. Ready to take your calls, prayer partners around America.
Tonight, welcome to our special Valentine show. Anybody in the mood for love? And I'm honored because tonight, for the first time, I get to host with my wonderful husband, Alvin Love. Would you show him some love? We have a great show in store for you tonight. So those of you at home, you don't want to move that channel.
That's right.
Find your wife, find your husband. Find
the kids. Find the kids, huh?
It's gonna be about relationships.
Right.
All right? Any married people in here tonight?
Yeah.
All right. Make some noise. Act like you're happy that you're there. Well, we're gonna have a great, 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 great show. But first, we wanna honor, first of all, Paul and Jan Crouch.
Absolutely.
Let's give them a hand. Thank you so much. The wonderful work and the way you're allowing God to use TBN. Thank you so much, and for allowing us to come here tonight.
Absolutely.
Amen.
Absolutely.
Then we want to honor the pastors that we have in the house. We have Bishop Buster Simmons from New Life Ministry. God bless you. Then we have Apostle Callie Mae Jasper of Holy City Faith and Deliverance Center. We have a rowdy bunch. We also have Reverend Earlene Oliver and Brother Jacob Oliver, Gethsemane Garden Baptist Church. God bless you. And then also our dear friends, Mr. and Mrs. Nathan Mew from Greater Allen AME Cathedral. Love you guys. Our first guest tonight, though, we really like him.
Oh, yeah.
He's a wonderful, wonderful man of God, and he has a great song entitled, is it kind of Forgiveness?
Right.
A Heart That Forgives.
A Heart That Forgives.
Anybody heard The Heart That Forgives? And I would say, Alvin, tell me if you agree, that that's one of the key ingredients of a great marriage.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely.
Everybody say forgiveness.
Absolutely, forgiveness. You gotta have forgiveness.
Gotta have forgiveness, right?
Exactly.
He said, exactly. I'm gonna make him talk tonight. What did you tell me before the show started? You said, everybody thinks CeCe's so nice. I'm gonna tell everything to her.
No, what I was saying was that I want you guys to tune in to the show tonight because I'm gonna give you all the secrets about CeCe. all the things that you wondered about her. If she is that nice all the time, tune in.
All right, now watch it. We gotta go home after this. Please put your hands together for the anointed, incredible Kevin Lavar.
To us, what a love, what a love.
Well, you look wonderful tonight.
I look wonderful?
Yes, you look very beautiful.
I think you look pretty good yourself.
Well, thank you. Thank you.
Better than pretty good. We've been married now for how long?
27 years.
27 years.
Twenty-eight in June.
And I tell everybody I still really like you.
Yeah, I like you too.
You know we have to love one another, but you know it's great to like one another.
Right.
And so, speaking of like, I love, our next guests are just incredible
people.
Oh,
the Flakes, yeah.
I mean, you know, certain people God brings into your life, and it's a confirmation that God really loves you, you know?
Yeah.
And that's the way I feel about these incredible people.
Yes,
please
yeah.
welcome Reverend Dr. Floyd Flake and his wonderful wife, Dr. Elaine.
Happy to be here.
And y'all sport this salt and pepper, like the bomb. I mean,
well,
it's just the bomb.
He's not far behind.
I'm catching up fast.
I love it. God is great.
And greatly to be praised.
Okay, so we know we have a lot to cover tonight.
Yes.
Because we all know how the enemy fights marriages.
Right.
And I know you guys been pastoring how long now?
35 years.
And pastoring? Greater Allen Ami Cathedral Church for 35 years?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And how long have you been married?
36 years.
36 years.
Wow.
Oh, Jesus! Wow. You started that quick. Did you know he was going to be a pastor when you said I do?
He promised me he would never pastor.
Heard that before.
So he started out with broken promises, huh?
But there is such a thing as a call.
That's right. Okay. Explain that.
What God calls you to do.
That's right.
And she said, you're happiest when you're in the pulpit. Mm-hmm. And
but that didn't mean he could pass.
He could preach, though. He could preach.
Preaching would have been fine, but pastoring is another whole thing.
Right.
Yeah, that's a lot.
So there is a difference, right?
And pastoring in New York. Preaching,
right?
It's
pastoring and in New York.
I'm an adaptable person, you know. Oh. I just believe in compromise and...
The truth coming out tonight.
This is gonna be great. I mean, it's gonna be the real deal here.
No script.
This is gonna work.
No
I love this though because we don't need it.
Yeah. Okay.
So you're
gonna
get okay.
It.
Well, I got a question for them.
Okay.
They've been married 36 years. So 30. What's the top three things that have kept your marriage together? You feel the top three? I know it's probably several, but the top three.
For me, it starts with the one thing we know, and that is that God put us together.
Mm-hmm.
And I know it because as we were together in Boston, we developed a friendship. Mm-hmm. And that friendship grew and grew until we were in a love relationship. And that love relationship was where we pretty much clearly identified who we were to each other. Mm-hmm. We didn't play any games with each other.
Right.
As a matter of fact, at that time, I was pretty free in the spirit.
In the spirit.
And she knew the people who I was expressing my freedom to.
Okay.
And, but they kept calling her to ask her how they could get to me. And so after a while,
that was fun.
She was the only one left.
Well, I wonder how that happened.
So that's the way we came together. And so we became great, great friends. And I think that's one point. And I think the other one is, I mean, God blessed me with a very, very, very intelligent woman.
Right.
Yes.
And,
she said right.
That's one point.
Yes, absolutely.
And I think it makes a difference when you can be on the same plane intellectually. Mm-hmm. And it also helps that It helps you to develop a kind of emotion that you understand each other, you think together, you flow together. It is not ever going to be where you don't have your disagreements.
Exactly. Right.
But if you have a disagreement
you know
and your wife writes you a letter, you know that we don't do this anymore. We will never do it that way
she
again.
She writes you a letter.
A letter.
Very good.
Yes,
very
yes,
good.
Yes.
Okay.
So,
no,
and she hasn't had
letter.
To write but one.
Oh, that's all that took. That's all that took.
Oh, that was enough. That one. Yeah, you write it well.
There's no number two letter, huh? Just one letter.
Just one letter.
That's awesome. Okay.
I think that I think being friends is really important, but I also think being adaptable because things just don't go like you want them to go.
That's true.
Life happens.
But someone said to me as we were getting married that love comes and goes, but the covenant is forever.
Covenant's forever.
And so that has kind of been with me for most of these 36 years. That you have to have a commitment not only to the person, but you have to have a commitment to the relationship. And when you have a commitment to the relationship, then you're willing to make the sacrifices, you're willing to make the adjustments, and you're willing to overlook some things and forgive some things, even if they never ask for forgiveness. You're committed to making it work.
That's good, that's good.
Committed to making it work.
Okay, with so many divorces going on, You've given us some secrets of how you guys have stayed together, but what do you think is missing nowadays when so many marriages are collapsing? They're not lasting. What would be maybe the top three things you feel like? Because I'm sure you do a lot of counseling in your guys' position, and you've seen a lot. So what do you think some of the main problems are? You first.
Well, I think there is that lack of commitment. That commitment, the vow that you made at your marriage ceremony, for which you paid much money to become a part of this relationship.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
A whole lot of money.
And you make a whole lot of commitments. And I think that the bottom line is commitment. If I am committed to this marriage, to this relationship, to what this relationship produces, whether it is children or whether it is where we are professionally, we have a responsibility in that commitment to be with each other and to come to common ground on most of those things that other folk would walk away from. Right. You have to believe in each other, and you have to have a conviction that says, I know, I don't necessarily like this particular thing, but there are more things that I like than I don't like, and and that's commitment.
That's good. Right. That's good. That's good. I've heard Bishop Japes talks about the 80-20.
80-20,
Be happy
with the 80. It could be 60-40.
It could be 60-40.
I know that's right.
That's true. So, what about you?
Well, you know, I think the whole notion of covenant escapes our many marriages today. I think that, and it's kind of a me thing. I'm not happy. I think that, you know, we're kind of in a generation where people are more into being sure that I'm happy. And many times you have to be willing to forgive and to give.
Absolutely.
To say, well, you know, it's not about me right now. It's about the marriage. It's about the relationship. It's about the covenant that we made.
Putting that first.
Trying to put it first.
I know one thing that's new and we didn't see a lot of earlier was marriage counseling. You know, a lot of people are going through marriage counseling now, which obviously is good, but is it really making that much of a difference? As you guys are pastors, I'm sure you guys
sometimes
counsel
you
a
wonder.
Lot.
You know, really have to wonder.
You guys do marriage counseling at your church?
Well, at our church, we send them through a whole series. And, you know, they go through it, and some make it and some don't.
It's no guarantee,
No guarantee.
Well, you guys said something. You said you got married, and then the next year you started pastoring.
That's a lot. That's a lot.
You guys deserve another applause for that. So, I'm sure there are a lot of young pastors out there pastoring, nowadays there's a lot of co-pastoring.
Yes. Right.
With the husband and wife.
Right.
How do you handle that balance? What challenges come from that?
Yeah, that's a lot.
And how do you handle that? Because I remember when Alvin and I started traveling, a lot of people said, oh, y'all marriage was good. It ain't gonna be good no more.
y'all together all the time.
Yeah. And you do have to set up different things in order to make it run smoothly.
Right.
So what challenges can you tell some of the pastors that are going through it right now that they can expect or maybe they can prevent?
Yeah.
Absolutely. Well, I think you get rid of, the first thing you have to do is get rid of any biases that you have. And
okay.
You know, from a historical perspective, there was always this notion that women did not belong in the pulpit.
Mm-hmm.
If God calls you and God calls your wife to be pastors together, you have to be pastors together.
Mm-hmm.
And that means you understand that in the direction that we believe God wants to take us in this covenant relationship, both the marriage and now the covenant relationship in terms of our ministry, we have to be together. And it does not mean that we're going to agree on everything.
Right.
But what it does mean is that we have enough respect for one another not going to do anything to cause them, the other party, to believe that you think they are less than you or that they don't really belong in ministry. You have to feel like we're in this together. We make decisions together.
Mm-hmm.
We decide the direction of the ministry together.
Absolutely.
And we ask God to keep on blessing us so that we might have new visions to continue to do new and greater things as a couple.
Right.
And it works.
That is good.
That's awesome. What about you, Doctor?
Well, I think the other thing, too, is that no two co-pastorates will be alike. You have to kind of know the flow of your marriage, know the flow of the relationship, and you have to kind of establish that flow so that, you know, you're not looking at what this couple is doing.
Mm-hmm.
We are pretty much, we're easygoing, and...
I love it. Yes, we are.
And we have kind of worked it out. You know, we've worked it out. I take care of the house in addition to all that I do at the church.
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of the way we flow. And so it's kind of understood that he does the larger scale things, and I do the day-to-day things, and that's fine with me.
That's right.
And I do the cooking.
Oh.
Oh.
This thought was good.
Very good. Very good. That's a good thing.
So is he a good cook? Is he a good cook? Is he a good cook?
He's a good cook.
Okay.
He's a good cook.
Okay.
Yeah. Why you say it like that?
No, he's a good cook.
He's a good cook.
I'm no good cook.
My children come home every week to eat it.
That's a good sign. That's a good sign.
That's a good thing.
But
no, she's a good cook.
Oh, okay.
She just watches if I start.
I just do it sparingly.
She just gets out of the way.
Well, that's awesome. So you're saying know the flow.
Right. Because you have to make it work for you.
Mm-hmm.
It can't be what someone else is doing. You can't try to fit into any kind of stereotypical molds. You just have to flow.
That's good.
And don't really get caught up in roles.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now that's one thing that has helped us too.
Awesome. Mm-hmm. Don't get caught up in roles.
Yeah.
Right. Because then when you're caught up in roles, then when something's not, you're not flexible.
Mm-hmm. You're not flexible, and you can't listen to people to tell you how you need to make your marriage work.
Oh, yeah. That's,
you
that's
have to figure
key.
Out for yourself how this thing is going to work.
Yeah. Everybody got an opinion.
Absolutely.
So one of the questions, Cece,
as being a preaching couple, you can't get caught up in competition.
Oh, say that again.
Because once you begin to compete, it's a problem.
It's a problem.
You have to deal with a whole lot of issues you don't, because the congregants pick up on that.
Mm-hmm.
And they begin to divide and conquer.
Really?
And if you're not careful, you find ministries falling apart simply because you had it together.
Right.
But you allowed that competition thing to get in the way. She's a far better preacher than I am. I truly believe that in my spirit.
Really?
And I acknowledge it because I watch her as she labors and put those sermons together and read the books and all of that.
Awesome.
I do the same thing. It just doesn't come out the same way.
Yeah.
but it's all to the glory. It's all to the glory of God, right? It's all to the glory.
But I guess my question, because you do hear about that, and that's something I really can't understand. Where does competing come from when you're both one, where does that come from?
You know, I heard a friend say that when you are one, when he hits a home run, I hit a home run. And when I hit a home run, he hits a home run. And so you have to kind of see it like that and understand that if you really are one, to be competing against yourself is rather dysfunctional.
Especially when you're competing against yourself. That's a good point. Good point.
And so you don't buy into it. And when that demon would rise, you just rebuke it.
Put it back where it came from.
That's ridiculous. Ooh, I could talk to y'all all day long. Let me ask you this. I'll start with you. Being a wife, a mother, and I know you get asked this question
all
a lot.
The time,
a pastor, all the things that you do, speaker. How do you balance it all? How do you prioritize? How do you make it work?
You know, I just kind of took one day at a time and didn't think about it, because if I thought about it, I probably would have fainted or something. But, you know, when I went back to seminary, I had four children. And then I was at the Allen Christian School. I was preaching and having a women's ministry and doing whatever. But it was, you know, I just did one day at a time and tried to prioritize appropriately, understanding that the kids couldn't suffer but so much, and so you having to make time for them. The one thing that I do appreciate about Floyd is that he helps. At, you know, he's always been an involved dad.
Awesome.
And he has not been the kind of guy that would express it anyway if he felt it, that he would, you know, I never had to feel like I was, I had to feel guilty for neglecting him. You know, if we were in a crisis time, he didn't have a lot of demands. And I think he can say the same thing about me.
Right.
That, you know, we just kind of look at the bigger picture.
Right.
And, you know, if you think about what's going on, and understand the larger scope of your lives and the demands on your lives, then you can't fall into that little pettiness, well, he's ignoring me or he's not spending time with me. Because, you know, it will come.
It will come.
But you have to move through your seasons with some level of maturity and understanding that, you know, this too can pass, it will pass. And then you can reshape your lives.
And you deal with your priorities. I mean, even while I was in Congress, she'll tell you, I flew home every night from Washington to New York while she was working on her doctorate. I was there doing homework with the kids, and I made it my business because
I decided... Hold on, we have to clap.
Because the marriage, the home was more important, and the church was more important to me than my political position. And so even though it was out of town, it was close enough that I could come back, drop the kids off in school in the morning, and go straight and get on the plane and stay in Congress all day. And then if that vote was over by 8 o'clock, I'm on the last plane out and back home. Even if the kids are in the bed when I get home, they know Daddy came home. And Daddy's gonna drop them off.
To the Flakes on and on because they got so much wisdom.
That's amazing.
I just want to ask Dr. one question here, and I know it's getting late, but the men, there's a lot of men who are seen to be walking away from their homes and walking away from their marriages nowadays. What do you have to say to these men?
I think these men need to get a grip on themselves. I think there is an element out there that have come to the conclusion that marriage really does not have to last this long. I don't have to stay with this woman forever. Mm-hmm. And then there's that pull on the part of many women, especially if they think you are successful, mm-hmm. that they are going to try to pull you out of that relationship.
Wow.
My thesis has always been, my father demonstrated well to me mm-hmm. the fact that if you're committed to the marriage, mm-hmm. that's what you commit your life to, and that's what you give all that you have to make it work. Mm-hmm. And you don't just walk away because something happened or something was said, mm-hmm. because no marriage is going to be perfect.
Right.
It's not going to be perfect.
Right. I think that's good. I think they're asking for a children today.
Would you do me a favor before you guys go? First of all, thank you so much.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Pleasure talking to you guys.
We love you so much. But I just want you to pray for the women. And maybe women in ministry and married women.
Okay.
And if you would just pray for the men, like Alvin said, that is such a huge problem right now.
Right,
men
right.
are leaving their relationships right, and uncovering right, the home. Right. And we know it's a trick of the enemy.
Yes.
And so if you would just pray for them, that would be great.
All right.
Okay, great.
Who's first?
Lord God, in the name of Jesus, we come on this day celebrating love and celebrating relationships. God, we come believing that through you, all things are possible.
Yes, Lord.
That relationships can survive. Yes. And that the women that you have called to those relationships can become the women, the wives that you created them to be.
Amen.
God, we pray for every woman who loves you. Amen. We pray for every woman who knows how to call your name.
Yes, Father.
And we pray, oh Lord God, that as she calls your name, that you would touch, that you would heal, and that you would restore.
In the name of Jesus.
So many of us have been through difficulties in life. So many sisters have known abuse, have known detachment, yes. been deserted, yes. been abandoned, been rejected. But God, we are so glad tonight
yes,
that we
Lord.
Know
Thank you, Jesus.
That you are Jehovah Rapha,
yes, Lord.
The God who heals.
Hallelujah.
You are Jehovah Jireh, the provider.
Yes, Lord.
And you take care of us. So, God, tonight we thank you for loving us.
Mm-hmm.
We thank you for opening doors for us.
Yes, Lord.
And we thank you for giving us what we need to live life abundantly. We pray for every marriage represented in the studio and in TV land.
Yes, Lord.
We pray, oh Lord God, that you would show women how to appropriately minister to her husband,
yes.
to their children, appropriately love them.
Yes.
And in the midst of all of that, maintain herself.
Mm-hmm.
So, God, we ask now that you would bless us and keep us. Help us, O Lord God, to rise above every pitfall and every trap that the enemy has set.
Jesus.
Let us remember that society cannot define us. But we are who you say we are.
Yes, Lord.
Yes.
And we pray this prayer in victory.
Yes, Lord.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
To thee, O God, we give praise and thanks. We honor and we bless your name because in your wisdom, you created man and woman.
Yes, Lord.
You created us that we might be one together. That we might know love and that we might know joy and have happiness. God, we pray for the brothers,
yes.
the brothers.
Yes, Lord.
That they do not allow themselves to get caught up in the moods and the modes as they change in the society of which we are a part. Deal with the reality of who they are and who God has consecrated them to be.
Mm-hmm.
Give them gifts so that out of the gifts that you give them,
yes, Lord.
They will have the ability to do things that measure to a level of success that is consistent with what your desire is for their life.
Please,
so that they do not become insecure
please,
and find Jesus. Themselves walking away because they don't think they measure up.
Yes.
Or find themselves in a position where they have been blessed to produce children and yet do not see a sense of responsibility for taking care of them.
My God.
God, we pray that you will give strength
yes.
to marriages.
Yes.
Help us to once again
yes.
have an appreciation to the degree that even as some things began to fall apart and break, we take the same spirit of our parents and foreparents and we say we're going to stay together. And we will stay together for the good of the family. We will stay together because this is a covenant relationship. And we will stay together because if we don't do what you have asked us to do and told us to do, we realize that we lose a part of ourselves. So God, help us to be whole men, giving of ourselves totally unto you, so that you might be able to focus in focusing on the family, to help us to know that we ought to stay together. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. Please welcome Kevin Lavar singing Soulmate.
I would give you the world if I had it to give. And I would give you my life if you needed it to live. My everything's not too much. Here's my love, my heart, and my trust, babe. 'Cause you're the only woman that makes the songs I sing make sense. And it's because of this I know there's no need to keep on looking anymore. When you're everything that I ask God for, 'cause you're my soulmate, you are the missing part of me. You are my soulmate. You're the one that brought me to my knees. You are my soulmate, the one the Lord Himself gave me, my soulmate. Where I'm weak, you are strong, so together we can't go wrong, no. That's why God put us together. We've got all bases covered. And no, there's no one in this world, no, that could ever love me better through sunshine, stormy weather. You're the only woman that makes the songs I sing make sense. It's because of this, I know there's no need for me to keep looking anymore. I don't have to look anymore, babe, 'cause you're everything that I ask God for. Oh, baby, you're my soulmate. Said you were the missing part of me. You are my soulmate. You're the one that brought me to my knees. You are my soulmate, the one the Lord Himself gave me. The love I've got for you is stronger than an ocean, stronger than an ocean wave. And it's enough love to last us the rest of our, last us the rest of our days. You bring so much joy to my life. I see so much more through your eyes. Nothing's ever felt so right. Father, nothing's ever felt so right. You're the only woman that makes the songs I sing make sense. And it's because of this I know there's no need for me to keep looking anymore. 'Cause you're everything that I ask God for. Baby, you're my soul.
Welcome, Kevin and Shondel.
Yes.
Lavar. beautiful song. Both the songs have been beautiful. Yes.
Yeah. So much feeling in your songs. I mean, you come from your soul, obviously. So much feeling. But before we get into the marriage, tell us about this project you just did at the Dream Center in L.A.
Oh, man. I'm so excited. Right? It's my sophomore project. We did it at the Dream Center in Los Angeles. Okay. And it was just so amazing. God put it in my heart to minister to the Josephs and the people with the overlooked potential, the ones that are the castaway of society. And that's what the Dream Center really focuses on.
Absolutely.
They go and get the people, for downtrodden.
Place.
Oh, my God.
Amazing place.
I went on a tour, and it was just amazing, the women that they rescued from the sex trafficking.
Yeah.
And they have their own floor, and they're protected, and they're loved back to life. And, I mean, people from all kinds of walks of life. And so what we did was we bussed in... like 800 people from all around Los Angeles, from Watts and Compton.
Wow, from the library.
They went out and we rented buses and brought them in.
Homeless and shelters and just 10 buses of people came through.
And so this whole CD is about destiny. It's called Destiny, Live at the Dream Center, and just speaking hope back into the lives of people who have given up on their dreams and, you know, feel like it's never going to happen. But if God makes a promise, He always makes it good.
Absolutely.
Great.
Awesome.
Change your life, though. It's an amazing place.
Yeah, we were there about 2 years ago, I believe it was.
Yeah,
about 2 years ago.
Yeah,
they took us on the tour. We went over
amazing.
To the studio, into the the building where they had the different programs that they have at the church.
They told us
so
that they
outreaches.
Feed 40,000
exactly.
people a week. They feed.
Yeah. Amazing. Amen. That's kingdom building
that's
right
kingdom
there.
Right that's kingdom right there.
Let's give the Dream Center a hand. He's talking about marriage now.
Yes.
You guys have a great story, and we'll get into it later, but you've been married now for how long?
Only about, what, 13 months?
13 months.
I'm keeping her happy. I'm trying to keep her happy.
You're trying to what?
I'm trying to keep her happy.
Yes.
Look at that smile on her face. I think she's doing a good job.
Well, great. Now, tell us your story, though. You've been knowing each other for a long time.
Yes. Our parents knew each other before we were born. His mom was at my mom's wedding.
Oh, really?
So that's how far back our family was.
Wow.
Really?
Yeah.
But we would have never, ever.
You managed him,
right?
Yes.
For 12 years?
12 years.
And we weren't even looking at each other like that, honest to goodness. It was
Come on.
Really?
12 years.
Seriously.
We were actually focusing on the music, huh? We were trying to help each other out.
He had another girl on his screensaver on his laptop.
And I'm trying to help her. I'm trying to hook her up. Checking out the guys, making sure, you know,
All right, so she managed you 12 years, and then what happened?
What happened?
We had
some kind of spark,
you know,
something happened.
I want to ask you first.
No, I want to hear his version.
We all want to hear his story.
Yeah. Kevin, you go first.
Okay, let's be real. One evening,
okay,
in
front of the house.
Here we go.
We were having a heated time of fellowship. We had a disagreement, and we were arguing, and I can't let stuff sit. Like, we may argue. It doesn't matter who I'm in relationship with.
Mm-hmm.
We can't leave that way. So I say, let's just pray, And in the midst of praying, something happened.
Yeah.
Not the argument, in the midst of praying.
I said, let's just pray, because it was just funky in the atmosphere. I said, it wasn't love in the atmosphere. I said, let's just pray. And as we were praying, I don't know what happened. It's just like something just came in the car.
And he said,
what did he say?
He said,
I can hear your version, Shondel.
Did you feel that? And I said, yeah. He said, well, what did you feel? I said, well, if we were a couple, it felt like it would have been a kissing moment. If we were a couple.
Are you serious?
Yeah. He said, oh, don't worry. I'm not going to kiss you.
So both of you guys at the same time.
So long story short, I leaned in and, I gave a kiss,
Okay.
And after that,
that was it.
We couldn't shake it.
That was it, damn.
We couldn't shake
well,
it.
Well, I guess
it.
Not. I guess. You leaned in and gave it.
After 12 years.
Yeah.
12 years.
Really?
And my testimony is, my senior year of high school, I asked the Lord, help me with me. you know, because I was promiscuous in high school, and I was like, God, you know, I really want to live for you now, you know, and he really got a hold to me, and I remember praying a prayer. I said, Lord, okay, so I'm 19 now, mm-hmm. and okay, so I'm gonna have to hurry up and get married, because you know I can't hold out now. Mm-hmm. 15 years later. I mean, God kept me for 15. He wanted to show you something. And I'll let her tell you. Hey, look, if you praise God about that one, wait till you hear her testimony.
Wow, that's awesome.
He's a keeper, right?
Yeah, he's a keeper. He's a keeper, 15 years.
He's a keeper.
People need to hear that.
They need to know that.
He's 15 years celibate. I was a virgin when I got married, and I got married. I was almost 39 years old.
Wow. So, hallelujah.
And it's awesome when you wait.
It is awesome. Even 38 years. Isn't that a blessing?
I hope I was worth waiting for. She was worth waiting for.
Hey, that's the way it is.
That's awesome because you both honored God. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's the thing about marriage. For it to work, you have to put God first. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You have to be, as the Flakes were talking about, being committed to the relationship. And that's that really means being committed to God, because when you're committed to God, then you're committed to your relationship.
Yeah.
I think that's the problem. I think it's the word commitment. I think it's committed to something. I think people frown from or run from, even though they may be in love. I think when they see that word, it's forever, you know. And they get afraid all of a sudden, you know, get cold feet.
We had this phrase, it was POP, which stood for purpose over passion.
Yeah. Mm.
Because we believed that God had put us together to be ministry partners. Mm-hmm. So even after that moment that we had in the car, we were like, something changed.
You know,
we still thought that God wanted us only to be ministry partners. Mm-hmm. So from that point on, we still were praying and saying, Lord, take these feelings away. We had people praying against us. You know, Lord,
people to pray against us.
We did.
Yeah, because we thought, hey, maybe it was just one of the moments, you know.
Wow.
And after, you know, several years of just, you know, man, this ain't going nowhere. And
Wait. Hold it. After several years, after that moment?
Maybe two and a half years.
Oh, I thought that was it right there.
Two and a half,
really?
3 years. Maybe two and a half, 3 years.
So y'all waited two...
So
who
this...
are you people?
And it was
Can I just say...
Wow.
It wasn't...
And I love that.
It was not easy. You know, she traveled with me, no problem. Mm-hmm. But, you know, after we kissed, I had to bring people with me now.
We took accountability partners everywhere we went. You really have to,
you know, because people don't... The flesh is real.
Oh,
and
yes.
it's not the enemy that's your biggest problem.
No.
It's you.
Come on.
So,
that's the pressure.
I mean, I really learned the grace of God and the mercy of God, you know, just in that time.
That's awesome.
And I just want to tell, I want to look in the camera and say, it wasn't easy.
Yeah.
But it was worth it.
But God's grace and His mercy, He kept us, and I'm so glad we waited.
That's great. That's amazing. Awesome.
And it was during that 3-year period that we were even praying for each other's spouses.
Yeah.
Because we honestly believed that we were only supposed to be ministry partners. So we said, okay, Lord, you know, whatever happened, you know, forgive us. And we were moving forward just in ministry, me as His manager. And we were praying for each other's spouses and didn't know the whole time we were praying for each other.
So when did that hit you in the head? When did you realize that, okay, you know what? This is the will of God.
Just a few months before we got married. I would say 6 months before we got married is when it really
hit us.
Something
like that. Yeah, because I'm the kind of person, when he speaks, that's it.
That's it.
Once I know for sure,
we're
going to march out on it. You
know? Good.
But if I'm not sure, you know, it's like,
yeah, you wait too.
And then God, he spoke, and that was it. And, I mean, family was kind of shocked, because they're like,
family was very shocked.
You know?
Yeah, after all these things, right.
But now they see what God has done, and bringing us together. And I've been so blessed to have her in my life. Mm. I mean, just for what I'm, even who I am, she's a help.
Mm.
Every woman's not a wife.
Ooh.
You know what I'm saying?
You better preach.
This is my thing. And it's not that they don't, some women don't have a desire to be.
Mm-hmm.
Some women, they don't want to, well, And some men, they don't have a us mentality. So let me just say, every man.
It's a meme.
It's because I hear some women like, every man. Every man's not a husband.
Right.
That's good. That's good.
Because yeah, you have to be, you know, willing to sacrifice, you know, and she teaches me, to be honest with you, how to love, how she loves me like every day.
That's honestly. That is awesome. And I'm sure working together for 12 years built an incredible friendship.
Yes.
Yeah.
Where you kind of, even though, I mean, you waited.
It was business, but still.
But yeah. But to bring that into the marriage, that relationship after so long, had to strengthen the foundation.
We didn't realize then all the conversations we were having during that 12 years of working together in ministry was really just preparing us for a marriage.
That's good. That's good.
Because half of the time I was working overseas, so we had to have telephone conversations. And so that meant you had to give undivided attention to the person. You know, we couldn't just watch TV and chat a little bit. You know, we were on the phone and having direct dialogue. And we went through all the different emotions, hanging up on each other, listening to each other.
Yeah, we did that too.
That's good.
But through all that time, we really learned how to communicate with each other. I learned his vision, which I think is so important because now I know his heart, and I know I can represent him without even having to ask him. And I know how to pray for him. And so all of those years, we never realized what we were going through, thinking it was just for ministry, that it was actually for marriage ministry.
Isn't she beautiful, though?
She is. She's beautiful. She's really
beautiful. A lot of people call her Little CeCe.
Well, that's a compliment to me.
That's
I think she's beautiful. You guys are so sweet. I love your spirits. I love what God is doing through you. But you wrote this beautiful lady a song.
I did.
Tell us about that.
Well, it's called Let It Be Known. Mm-hmm. And I actually wrote her one song that she walked down the aisle to. And the song I'm going to do tonight is called Let It Be Known. And it's just saying, you know, let there be no doubt, because there might have been people that might not have been sure. You know, are you sure this is the one? No, let it be known. She's it.
There's no doubt.
She's it for me. And I'm not looking anymore, so this is it.
That's good. That's good.
When we were interviewing the Flakes, you know, they were mentioning about the three things that were important in a marriage. And one they mentioned was being friend with each other. Friendship is so important. And I know with CeCe and I, that has been the thing that has kept us, because even when times are not going so well, when you like each other and you have that friendship, you can communicate, it's so important. Yeah. So have you guys found out, I mean, by working together for 12 years, obviously, there was some communication you guys had together that was strong. So did that carry over into your marriage at all? Or how did that play it?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You know what's surprising to me is that we spend every waking moment, like, together. And like you said, we actually do still like each other.
That's good.
I mean, that's, because people, I mean, people have their philosophies about marriage and, oh, you know, you got to have, you know, there's no way you could
you
work
have
together.
Your time. Yeah,
you can't work together.
Space.
And that's just not our testimony. It's not. And, you know, we're human beings, so of course you have your, you know, that's really getting on my nerves right now. Of course you have that, we're real people. But at the end of the day, I was always taught, you know, never go to bed angry.
Absolutely.
That's awesome.
Absolutely.
Never go to bed angry.
Let the sun go down on your wrath.
So, Shondel and I do this thing. We when something has happened, we'll say, and what do we do in the Lavar household?
Forgive quick.
Forgive quick.
Say that again. Say it louder.
Forgive quick.
Forgive quick.
She'll hit me with it, and sometimes like,
you don't want to hear it. You might not want to hear it
Might not want to hear it. The same thing, I'll do it for her. But if you let
it works.
If you let stuff stay,
that's good.
I mean, that thing will ruin. It'll cause you guys to really, you know, fall apart.
Well, what you don't want to happen is you don't want a root of bitterness to start growing. You know, you want to sever that thing right when it hits, you know. And I think that's what happened with couples. They go to bed, they wake up with the anger, with the hurt, you know, and that thing start taking root in them. And next thing you know it, it becomes a stronghold in their life, you know. So for any couples out there, you know, like you said, don't go to bed angry. Get it resolved. Get it resolved right then and there. And don't carry it over.
And you've got to be willing to talk it out with transparency and vulnerability. And I think that's the key thing, you know. Sometimes you might have to yell it out. Sometimes you may have to cry it out. But I think it's just so important that you get it out and that there's an understanding that in those moments, it's a safe zone. Mm-hmm. And it's a safety zone for you to be able to express and to listen to each other. Because that's the thing. Once we listen and we talk, then we eventually hear each other. And then that's when we get to a resolve.
That's good.
And she's always right.
She's always right.
He's learned!
He's going to work.
In only 13 months, he learned.
And we also found out, tonight that sometimes a letter works too.
Right. I was listening.
So, will you sing that song for us now?
I will, absolutely.
Awesome.
Absolutely.
Let's welcome one more time, Kevin Lavar.
Till I fell down on my knees and God showed me that you were His very best for my life. And if I wanted to be blessed, I better make you my wife. And I'm so glad you said yes to me. You said yes to me. And I thank God we got married, we got married. Let it be known, I love you. Let it be known, you're my very best friend. Let it be known, no one on earth's above you. You're my pride that stands by my side. Let it be known. Let it be. You see me laugh, you see me cry. You taught me how to show the love I held deep down inside. I'm a better man because of you. Because of you, I love God more. And I'm so glad you said yes to me. You said yes to me. And I thank God that we got married, we got married. Let it be known, I love you. Let it be known, you're my very best friend. Let it be known, no one on earth's above you. You're my bride that stands by my side. So let it be known, I love you. So let it be known, you're my very best friend. Let it be known, no one on earth above you. You're my pride that stands by my side. Let it be known, oh, let it be. Let it be. Casting out a sign, no limits on our love, our future's bright in Jesus Christ, the Lord above. So let it be.
And we just found out that today is Kevin's birthday. Kevin Lavar. Yeah. Happy birthday, Kevin.
I didn't even know that. They told us.
Well, our next guest is professional.
Yes.
Right? Well, all of them have been professional, but
he's
this is what he does.
He's a doctor.
Doctor,
He's a doctor, but he counsels.
Family counseling.
Yeah, family counseling.
Right.
Okay.
Okay. Next, we have our next guest is from Elk Grove, California. Is Dr. Ron Elmore.
Very good. Hello. Welcome.
Thank you.
Thanks for being here. We were talking in the back, and you let me know that this wasn't your plan to be Dr. Ron Elmore.
Never meant to be in ministry, never meant to be in psychologist, never meant to be doing this. Didn't see it coming. I'm a fourth generation pastor's kid. And I told everybody, this is the end of all of those generations of pastors. I ain't gonna do that.
You made that announcement.
Yeah, I meant to be right here in New York. I came here, the Dance Theater of Harlem brought me here to train as a dancer, and that's the career I expected to have forever. But the Lord shifted things around and changed my life in a way that I didn't see coming. And I found out, I had a dirty little secret when I got into ministry. Mm-hmm. I was the only minister I knew who didn't care to preach. And if they asked me to preach, I said, it's okay. But the pastor, who was my pastor at the time, said, I noticed that you don't like to preach, but I do notice you love to sit in a room with people with messed up lives and marriages. And since you like that so much, this church is going to send you back to get your doctorate in clinical psychology and let God use you that way. Okay. And that's what they did.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
That's awesome. It's a blessing when other people can recognize the gift in you. Because a lot of times you don't see the gift in yourself.
Oh, absolutely. Right.
And so it's a blessing with others over you.
I came from a generation that said, you're either going to be a pastor or a missionary. That's the only options.
Only two options.
If you say you've been called. And I found out there's other options.
Okay. Other options. Awesome. So you've had this passion to help people. And when you got your doctorate, you begin to do what?
You know, I came along in the waiting to exhale generation.
Okay.
And so it was kind of fortuitous that the Lord called me into this ministry at that time, because I was in Los Angeles and finished my doctorate in clinical psychology. I had already been to seminary. Mm-hmm. And I was saying, God, can you show me how to merge the two? The unsaved folks say psychology is the way. Mm-hmm. The saved folks say it is the Bible and only the Bible. Mm-hmm. And God can't speak no other way but the Bible.
Well, that's right.
And
that's
I said,
right.
Lord, there's got to be a way that you use all of this. The earth is yours. The abundance mm-hmm. of it is yours. Mm-hmm. And so I prayed for a way to integrate it. So I started in private practice. And every hour I'd go out to my lobby to bring in my next client as I was building my client load. And I noticed that sitting in my lobby all the time was only women and single women. And I'd bring them in and they'd say, I got a unique situation, Dr. Ron. I'm a Christian. I love the Lord, but I really want to be married and want to be in relationship. And men don't like me and God must not like me. And why ain't I married? And how do you do it? And how do men work? And how do they think and all that? So I let them go and I'd go out to the lobby and get the next client. Same question, same issues day in and day out. So I said, I want to counsel people on depression and death and despair. So let me get all of these single women out of the way. So I set up a seminar called the How to Love a Black Man Seminar. And I said, I'm going to get all of those women
together.
All of us, just knock it all out and get on back to bipolar disorder and all that kind of stuff. Yeah, knock it out. And so I said, if I can get all 20, 25 of these women all in that same place, it's going to work great. We opened the doors at the Ramada Hotel in Culver City, California, for the How to Love a Black Man Seminar. 250 women walked in. The fire marshal came and said, no more people can come into this room. So
we scheduled
the next one. The next How to Love a Black Man Seminar, 250 women came in. And I said, Lord, maybe you are showing me something that you want to use me for uniquely. And I had a friend and mentor who said, you will never be able to deliver the message that God has given you about relationships for men and for women, for couples. Mm-hmm. You won't be able to do it one by one where they all come to your office. You won't be able to seminar it enough for everybody to hear it. You got to write a book. Well, I said, I got attention deficit disorder. I can't even write a letter. Let alone a whole book.
So
he said, well, you do one sentence at a time. And I wrote my first book, How to Love a Black Man. And after that, How to Love a Black Woman, and then my marriage book, An Outrageous Commitment. And that's when I knew that whether I was a pastor or a missionary or whether a dancer or an actor, this is what God has called me to do. This is what I love to do.
Oh, I love that story. Well, tonight we're talking about marriage.
Yes. He's the man to talk to.
We're talking about marriage.
Even your own.
Did you find out anything new tonight that you didn't know?
My wife and I celebrated 30 years married back in November, but I actually did learn some new stuff tonight.
Great. So it's an ever-learning thing.
Absolutely. If it's not an ever-learning thing, it's a boring thing. And
that's what
makes marriage so such an outrageous commitment. It's the
only thing
that we are called upon to do till you die. You don't have to live in the same house you were born in till you die. You don't have to work at the same job till you die. You don't have to keep the same friends till you die or go to the same church till you die. The one thing that we voluntarily say, Lord, we're going to do this till we die.
Till we die.
Is marriage. We're gonna do this till we die.
That's
when you ain't
true.
As cute as you were today. We're gonna do this
every day.
We're gonna do this when your hairline is gone back. We're gonna do this when I love you, but I'm just sick of you. I'm tired of waking up to you.
We're gonna stay together
too. It's quite a commitment. And so I think the value that we place on it, we act like it's all fun and games, or other people swing to the other side and act like it's all drudgery and misery and going to the cross. Yeah. It's a beautiful, wonderful. Fun, challenging, difficult, scary, boring, exciting thing to do.
I love that.
It's all
is that all in your book?
Absolutely. that's what an outrageous commitment is all about.
How to love a black woman.
How to love a black man. I'll tell you something, Alvin, though. That came out, as I said, in the Waiting to Exhale days.
Okay.
And so when I brought the manuscript to New York publishers, they said, there's a lot of Mars and Venus. There's a lot of advice for relationships. They said, but there's nobody saying anything just to black folks. So why don't we put black in there, use the same advice? And that's what we did. So I say, if you're How to Love a Black Man, How to Love a Black Woman, it's the book for you. If it's How to Love a White Man, How to Love a White Woman, orange, green, purple, yellow,
it's the same book.
Erase the black, move on with the advice.
We all go through the same issues.
I love that. Much more alike than we are different.
So, okay,
back to the exciting, challenging. What other words?
Exciting and challenging,
adrenaline rush.
Something I want more of, something I want less of. It's all of that. I mean, think about it, you guys. In Deuteronomy chapter 7, you know that passage where God reiterates the covenant with Moses. It says these interesting words. He says, it's almost like he said, Moses, let me get you straightened out. I did not choose you because I didn't have other options. You weren't the greatest of the people. As a matter of fact, you were the least of the people. And I picked you. And it says something interesting there in the original language. It says, translated into English, I set my love upon you. It says, I chose to set my love upon you. When you look back in the original language, that word set is a word that has to do with what someone used to do in the Jewish culture in the ancient days of bringing their sacrifice to God, bringing it to the priest and to the altar. Now, you didn't get any credit for having a relationship with God just because you were standing in line with your sacrifice. God, it wasn't recognized by the priest or by God. You didn't get any credit for it when it was your turn, and I'm now about to put the offering up there. No, it didn't count. It didn't even count once you put the sacrifice there and said, oh, wow, this is it, God, here it is. Guess when the sacrifice counted? It was looked upon by God, and he responded to it, and the priest responded to it. It was after you intentionally put it there, and then you remove your hands
from it and let it
signifying,
go.
I don't know what's going to happen. I've made my commitment known, but I don't know what's going to happen. And that's how God extends his love relationship with us. He's going, well, he's God. That makes sense for him to do that. But then Jesus messed it up for us. In John chapter 13, on the night that Jesus was arrested, he said, now, tell you what, disciples, we've been together 3 years. A new commandment I give you. The old commandment, you shall love each other like you love yourself. Well, I'm sick, got all kind of insane issues. Sometimes I don't love myself.
So he said,
the new standard, it doesn't erase the old one, upgrade from coach to first class.
Exactly.
He says,
exactly.
The new one is love each other as I have loved you.
How has he loved us?
He set his love upon us, and then he waits to see what our response is, and he doesn't decide, I'll set my love once I know you're going to love me back. Nope, I'm going to set my love upon you and hope you love me back.
Unconditional.
Because I want you to love like that. But
you said something while you were explaining it. You said it's up to you.
It is. Yeah, we don't like that. We like, a lot of times as Christians, I did this because God told me to do it. I did that because God, I'm wearing my green shirt because God said don't wear the blue one today. Only. And there is this idea of obedience and sincerity of submission and compliance and obedience to His word that is a part of our worship and our intimate relationship with God. But there is this thing that we tend to have trouble with as Christians, and that is that He has given us a liberty that means we must make choices. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that means I have the choice to love a loving God back or to not love Him back. And marriage is exactly that.
That's right.
I can make a choice every day. I sure did love you on our wedding day. You looked fine. You had on lace. I had on a tuxedo. I had to give it back the next day, but I looked good.
Looked good that day.
I had on a tuxedo. Music was playing. Ribbon in the Sky was playing behind us. And my mama was there, and your mama was there.
Everything was right.
I choose to love you today. Yeah. Honeymoon comes. I definitely choose to love you. Somebody else is making the bed, and somebody else is cleaning up the hotel room. Yeah, somebody else is cooking the food. I choose to love you. Come back home, and 10 minutes after the honeymoon is over. You ain't as much like me as I thought you were. You're so different.
That quick, all right?
I don't know if I choose. And it is. It can be that quick. And so now we've got until death do us part to love somebody who, lo and behold, they are more different than us than we thought.
Oh, yeah.
We see the similarities to start. Ah, I love my wife because her middle name started with an L and my middle name starts with an L.
Oh, wow.
I love jazz music and she plays jazz music and I'm a pastor's son, she's a pastor's daughter. I said, that's God confirming our union with signs and wonders.
Signs and wonders. Our middle name.
Then I realized that just like in my marriage and just like in every marriage, I fooled around and went out there and became attracted to somebody who is like me in many ways, but in many ways ain't like me.
Right. Mm.
I am an extreme introvert, so I make my living talking, but to be able to talk and be with people, I have to recharge my battery by myself. I married the world's biggest extrovert. She collects people.
She collects people.
Don't even have to knock. We probably
just come on in.
Come on in. I, on the other hand, tell people, 6 months from now, sometime after we've planned everything, after I've had a nap, taken my medication, had my prayer, I invite you to come over. We'll fellowship together. And so we found out in many ways we're different. Right. I think fast and talk fast. She prays slow and processes methodically. I say, use the good sense God gave you. She says, I am waiting to hear the voice of God speak. And so our relationship, as is your relationship after all these years, and everybody's marriage relationship after all these years, is a covenant to accept and love and to keep on accepting and loving and bringing your best stuff to somebody who is delightfully not like you and disgustingly not like.
Not like you. Disgustingly not like you.
Like both of them.
Both are true.
Both.
I love the difference. I love the fact that because she's so extroverted, I've got more friends than I ever would have had. Me being introvert. I would have had two friends at this stage of life. I got bunches of friends. Why? Because I kind of got it by osmosis because I'm married to her. Uh-huh. Well, she likes the fact that the difference between us is that I can treasure solitude and meditation and reflection, and she's learned how to be alone in prayer and meditation and to nurture that side of her life. So we love the difference. But in conflict, we hate the difference. I want her to talk as fast as I talk fast. You got something to say, you better say,
say it.
Don't make me read between the lines.
You know, read between the lines.
She wants me to dress it up, smooth it out, and that's when the difference disgusts us. And so isn't that the kind of love that God has shown to us? It's in many ways, we're like Him. We're created in His image. But look closer. In many ways, we ain't like Him. Mm. He's a holy God. I am an unholy Ron. He is an eternal God. I'm a sometimey, temporary Ron. He is a God worthy of worship. I am a Ron worthy of death. Mm. Now, when He went out to pick relationship, who did He pick? Somebody who ain't like you. And demonstrates His love toward us. And then Jesus says, before I get out of here, y'all love each other like I love you.
That's awesome. So let's talk to the people who aren't married yet. Maybe they're thinking about being married. Maybe they're praying about it. What do you feel? And maybe they're not. Maybe they're
praying against it. 100 million of them in America alone right now.
100 million
singles. Yeah.
Singles.
100 million.
So what is your advice for them to prepare? How would you explain to them to prepare for marriage?
I want to hear this. You know, I can't believe you asked me that question, because when I'm with unbelievers and give the answer that I'm about to give, they're good with it. When I'm with Christians, they have a real problem with it.
Oh, Lord.
Because somebody has put out some stuff that says something about it being God's idea for you to sit up passively, sit on the edge of your bed, and wait for God, keep your window open so he can blow your mate in through the window. They'll have a little halo on their head. They'll have your name written on their lapel.
Okay.
And that's how you'll know that that's God's
mate
for
okay.
you.
Okay.
But the fact of the matter is that relationship and preparation for marriage and singleness and dating is a matter of stewardship just as much as tithes and offerings are a matter of stewardship.
Wow.
And so it means, they hate this when I say this, it means date a lot. It means
really?
Take the date. It means get out there with your charming, gorgeous, handsome, broad-shouldered, long-legged, long-haired, short-haired, chocolate, yellow, beige, caramel self. And present yourself as God's gorgeous gift and somebody's blessing. Don't stay in the shadows and just say, I'm waiting on God's time. What if this is God's time? And your job is to make yourself noticeable. You got, I've been a marriage counselor, a therapist, and a relationship coach for going on 25 years now.
Okay.
One of the things that I have started advising people about after all these 25 years is I have found out that there is so much a part of relationships that's on God. You're not in control of it. You're not in control of whether this relationship is going to work, whether this was the guy, if the guy or the girl is ever going to come.
Right,
not in
right.
control. Is this the one that's going to lead to marriage? Not in control. Don't know. There's a God who got some say-so about it. There's another person who's got some say-so about it. But because we don't have control over all the pieces, some people throw the baby out with the bathwater and don't exercise stewardship over any parts of it.
Oh, that's good.
So I'm not praying for a mate, because some kind of way God's going to be insulted if I pray for a mate. Some kind of way God, who came up with the whole idea of marriage in the first place.
Right.
Not like Adam was walking around Eden and saying, God, I got this idea. Can you think about this?
Think about this, guys.
I know you never thought about this, but what if you create somebody that's kind of like me? I'm kind of like them.
She's naked,
I'm naked. We become one flesh. No! God came up with the idea. So, yeah, preparation for it is finding out, how can I prepare my insides? How can I prepare myself to be bold and courageous? Because dating and relationship and marriage takes being bold and courageous.
Yeah.
It's not for wimps. You can get your feelings hurt up in here. You can go crazy up in here. You can be companioned and loved and blessed and supported up in here. So, if you want to be safe, don't do dating and relationship.
If you want to be
safe, if you want to be in love and in marriage, then you're gonna have to say yes to the dangers of dating and relationship.
Wow. That's good.
We got a big God, isn't that? What is this for?
That's awesome.
I've been talking about exactly that. You know, you guys, I'm touring the country right now.
I want to know about the tour,
Oh, thanks. Yeah, it's called the Rock Solid Marriage Tour.
Okay.
So at the same time, I'm gonna go around to big churches and little churches talking about not just the theory of it, husbands love your wives. Well, a lot of husbands are going, how? What's the way I'm supposed to do it? What's the way I'm supposed to do it when prayer is right and sex is right and money is right? And what's the way I'm supposed to do it when I ain't feeling it and she ain't feeling it? We talk about the nuts and bolts, practical issues of it. How do you do it? How do you get a marriage, sustain a marriage?
Right.
How do you continue in it when it feels differently than you want it to? And so little churches and big churches, I found that we are hurting enough in our marriages and broke enough to where we can't afford divorces, that we're willing to listen now.
Can't afford divorce.
It's like God did with the children of Israel.
Right.
He broke them down so low that they were willing to go, God, you got anything you want to say to us now? Anything you want us to do?
Right.
At the same time, I'm doing the Rock Solid Marriage Tour. I'm going to big churches and little churches doing what's called the Relationship Ready National Seminar Tour.
Really?
And that's working with singles, on good, godly, no-nonsense dating and relationships.
Oh, my good. How do we find out about this?
It's all at drron.com. That's D-R-O-N-N. I'm sorry, D-R-R-O-N-N.com. And click on the link for the Rock Solid Marriage National Tour.
Rock Solid.
Ron with two N's. And the Relationship Ready Tour. One for singles, one for marriage. And amazing things are happening in churches and communities that God is letting old Broadway gypsy move around from town to town, not doing a show, but standing before people and trying to tell them how God wants us to love.
Wow. So on this tour, are you doing it by yourself or is it others on it?
It's me.
Just you?
It's just okay. Me. It's really
simple. He is
simple
definitely
thing.
A one-man show.
He's a one-man
sure.
show. Wow.
Yeah. This is great. Yeah, so God is using you to bring families back together, to make people whole again, to getting us to really thinking.
Getting us to think and getting us to endure some hardship.
Oh,
nobody needs
good.
A marriage coach like me when everything is plenty money in the bank, the kids are doing right, they got scholarships to college, we've got the 4,000 square foot home and three cars in the garage. Yeah. We like our church, we like our pastor, and we feel the Holy Ghost every day. Nobody wants marriage counseling at that point.
Right.
Wow.
But a part of this is just like with Jesus, they will bow down before you and say, Hosanna, you will be the guest of honor at the Passover feast, and the next day you will be the one that will be taken and ripped away from your beloved and sent before those who would be cruel to you. That's how marriage is. It's good this day and bad this day. We need the skills for enduring hardship in marriage. Why? I love all the people that I minister to, and I hope couples do better and this and that, but I'll tell you the truth. I could care less about, grown folk are grown. What I do know is the school where the next generation, our kids and our grandkids, is going to learn what marriage looks like is at our house.
That's right, that's right.
They're not going to get it from my book. They're not going to get it from coming to therapy in my practice in California, or coaching with me on the telephone or Skype. They're not going to get it from my seminar because they ain't invited to the seminar. Our kids, my children, your children, are going to learn what God's kind of love in marriage looks like. For better or for worse, from looking at us.
From looking at us.
Well, they're gonna learn it a crazy way or a godly way.
Right.
It's all wonderful them.
Oh, thank you so much for coming. Let's give them a hand. Rock solid marriage seminar
tour.
That is.
You coming
awesome.
To Nashville?
I sure hope so.
I
bring me to Nashville.
So.
And I will.
I know a few that needs to be.
Awesome. Yeah. Thank you so much.
I know an emerging pastor in Nashville who just might invite me.
That's right. You're starting some now. Please put your hands together one more time for my friend, Kevin Lavar. Bring it a heart that for you.
Father, this is my prayer. Father, this is my prayer. I want a heart that forgives, a heart full of love, one with compassion, just like yours above. One that overcomes evil with goodness and love, like it never happened, never holding a grudge. One a heart that forgives, that lives and lets live. One keeps loving over and over again. One that men can offend, 'cause your word is deep within. One that loves without price, like you, Lord Jesus Christ. Father, I want a heart that loves everybody, even my enemies. I want a love like you, be like you, just like you did, Lord. Father, I want a heart that forgives. Heart that forgives, Lord. I want a heart that forgives when the ones that are closest, that I've known the longest, they hurt me the most. I still want to love them just like you love me. Father, even though I'm hurting, Lord, you know they hurt me so deep. God, I want a heart that forgives. Lord, when the pain is so deep and it's so hard for me to speak about it to anyone, but just like your son, Father, I give up my right to hold it against them with hatred inside. Father, I want a heart that loves everybody, even my enemies. I want to love like you, be like you, just like you did. I want to walk like you, talk like you, just like you did. I want to love them anyway, Father, no matter what they do, no matter what they say, Lord. Because the heart that forgives is the heart that will live totally free from the pain of the past. And the heart that lets go is the heart that will know so much freedom. But today the question is, do you want to be free? Lord, I want to be free. I know it hurt, but I don't want to live this way no more, Lord. I don't want to be in this bondage anymore, Lord. God, I want to move on. Lord, you know it ain't easy. Father, you were there when they did what they did to me. God, I need your help. I can't depend on nobody else. Father, I need your help. Father, I need your help. Father, would you help me let it go, Lord? I don't want to hold on to this pain and hurt anymore, Lord. I want to be free. I don't want to be bound for the rest of my life. I can't love nobody right now, and I need you to heal me. Father, give me a heart that gives. What mama did,
thank you, Kevin. Isn't that a beautiful song? Yeah. Have you enjoyed him tonight? Kevin Lavar. Awesome, awesome song. Forgiveness is really the key.
It's absolutely the key. Absolutely the key.
Yeah. We've had an incredible time tonight, huh?
Yes, we have. Great guests. Awesome. Great guests. Heard some things that we didn't know about, writing letters.
Yeah. I can go home and practice my letter writing.
Absolutely. You don't need to do that anymore.
No. It's we kind of got it going on right now.
I think so.
Yeah, we'll keep it going,
right.
Because God is great.
27 years.
Yeah. I mean, 27 years. And the thing is, we've learned the key, you know, and that's first of all having the Lord in our lives.
Absolutely.
Both of us submitting to Him. Mm-hmm. You've always been my best friend.
You've been my best friend.
You've always supported me, mm-hmm. 200%.
Yeah.
And I just thank God for you've always covered me, you've prayed for me. Mm-hmm. And I don't know. I mean, marriage is really wonderful. I love being married. I love being married.
Would you marry me again if I asked?
I would. I would marry you again.
Would you ask me?
Would I ask you again? Yes, I would.
You would ask me?
Absolutely.
Very good.
Absolutely.
All right. Well, thank the Lord, brother. Well, our next guest...
they're friends of ours. We love them.
We love them.
We've loved all our guests, but we've been knowing Andrea and Lewis for,
for a long time.
Long time.
She can sing.
Oh, yeah. She comes from the McClurkin family. They all can sing.
Please put your hands together for Lewis and Andrea Mellini. Love you.
Hey, my friend.
Well, Andrea, I noticed I called you Andrea Mellini.
Yes, thank you.
Right? Yes. People think my name is Winans.
Yeah.
And I haven't been a Winans for 27 years.
Yeah. Absolutely.
But kind of got stuck with that name, which I love the name. Yeah. But I love Love better.
Yeah.
Right?
It's like I love Mellini better.
Yes. For those of you who don't know, this is Sister McClurkin.
Yes.
Andrea Mellini.
You like the Mellini,
too.
Yes, the Mellini. Now, how long have you guys been married?
470
years. I thought you were
last month was 23 years.
Yeah. Last month, 23.
Long enough phone. You guys are close to us. Yeah. 27.
That's how long we've been knowing each other.
Yeah. That is great. Great. How many kids?
Three.
So did you guys date a long time, or did you know it like right off the bat, or did, were you like Kevin?
No,
like 12 years.
It's the truth being told.
Okay. We'll let you tell the story because this one, I know he's cut up.
No, he can't wait to tell his.
No. Go ahead.
No,
honesty.
When we first met him, when me and Donnie were, you know, doing Don't Get Got Started,
right?
He was the road manager.
I remember that.
Yeah.
Yes.
And we hated
about
him.
About that.
You hated him?
I forgot
hated.
You were the road manager.
Oh, well, you know, road managers are rough.
They made you be on time and, you know, blah, blah, blah.
I mean, you got to keep the crew going, keep them in line.
Yeah, but he had his picks and chooses.
Oh, really?
That's not true.
Okay.
That's not true.
So when did this relationship change from... Oh, that role
Task
manager.
Taskmaster, too.
The role manager.
Yeah, the role manager.
How did that happen? Who wants to answer that?
Well.
Keep on talking. Go ahead.
He was, you know, also the stage manager. So I was very, you know, I was always by myself. And, you know, I didn't hang out with everybody, and I would, you know, have my Bible or a newspaper, and I would sit on, you know, the left or right stage on the stairs. And, you know, they were saying, don't get your robes dirty, don't get your robes dirty. So I would put down paper towels on the stairs and sit. So when I would come back, he would write a note on the paper towel. Okay. And then when we start passing notes.
Pretty good.
Lewis kind of initiated this.
I would just write, you know, hi, how are you today? Because she would do that. I would call the show, the light cues and all that stuff from the stage.
Right.
And there was a podium. And she would sit there, and she would just show up all the time and be very quiet and this statuesque, beautiful woman.
Yes, she is gorgeous. She is.
And she would just sit there and be very quiet. So I would just slip her little notes, and that turned into a whole letter writing thing started.
Right.
And then the rest is history.
So no actual conversation, just kind of writing notes?
Well, no, it moved to conversation.
like nowadays, Twitter, keep texting each other.
Sitting next to each other in bed, FaceTime.
That was before texting. No texting at that time. No cell phones.
But speaking of Twitter, I hear you put a strong message out on your
Facebook.
About being in love and how you're sticking with your husband through the good and bad. And my question is, after 23 years, how do you still have that? How do you still have that fire, that fight, that determination?
Well, you know, 23 years, you know, you're gonna go through the highs, you're gonna go through lows, you're gonna make mistakes, you know, you're just gonna mess up. And, you know, in marriage, well, as far as I'm concerned, there's not an exit clause, you know? And, you know, whether he's right or wrong, I'm still, you know, sticking with them. You know, it's ride or die.
Yeah.
You know, you make a mistake, you do something crazy, whatever. We're gonna work it out, we're gonna pray, we're gonna ask forgiveness. If you do something at 12:01, at 12:02, we're okay. You know, because we're gonna work it out.
That's
you know,
a blessing.
And there's nothing that, you know, happens between us that's so horrible that we
can't resolve it.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it really goes to speak to some of what are the other guest said, and that was this thing about commitment and covenant.
Covenant. Yeah.
I mean, we serve a covenant-keeping God.
Yeah.
And I think part of the problem is we've forgotten that in our marriages. It truly is a covenant.
It is.
And we have to have that commitment that there is no out.
There's no out.
See, the problem is we live in a microwave society. You can get an easy divorce in 15 minutes. There's always an out. There's not an out.
There's not an out.
There's not an out. And if you really think about it and say, okay, there's no out, then the option is you have to work it out.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Oh, I like that.
That's good.
Because there's nothing else. If you remove the option of breaking up out of the equation, then you have to figure out how to compromise, come to common ground, keep peace in your house, because you want peace.
You want peace, yes. You want peace.
Yeah.
That's good. Covenant.
Well, Dr. Ryan was saying something about how it's so important for the next generation to see that in the home.
Yes.
He said they can read my book, they can go to his seminar, but it's what they see in the home. So that's why it's so important as parents that we understand that even the kids see us, if you're not disagreeing or you're getting along, but how do you resolve it? They need to see that.
Yeah.
They need to see that every day is not going to be perfect.
Right.
But whatever it is, we can work it out.
Right.
You know? And let me tell you, honestly, both of us didn't come from homes that modeled that. I had a loving mother that raised three kids whose father split. I didn't have that model. My mother gave me everything she could, and she really taught me how to love unconditionally. And I had to take that and learn from my relationship with God, how to bring that and model that in the home.
That's good. That's good.
In the home. One of the things that in our life, you talk about the ups and downs. One of the things that happened is there was a scripture that blew my mind because I got a real revelation of it. In Ephesians 5 and 25, husbands, love your wives
as Christ,
even as Christ loved the church and gave himself for her. When I thought about that in this context, Jesus loved me and died on a cross for me when I rebelled against him, when I didn't please him, when I was contrary to him, when I lived other than anything that would make him happy. That's what he did on the cross for me when I was in that state.
Right, right.
So now, how am I supposed to love her?
That's good.
My love isn't predicated then upon what she does.
That's good. That's good.
It's predicated on me having the mindset and the heart set to love on her even if she's not pleasing me.
Yes.
It takes all the pressure off of her.
That's good.
That's good.
And puts it in a decision.
I hope they hear
because that's how he loves me. And let me tell you, that's not always easy.
Right.
It's not always easy. But I have to go back. He loved me when I was jacked up. And guess what? I'm still not perfect.
That's right.
And he still loves me.
Yeah, right.
And we need to get back to that kind of commitment to the process of love. Your other guest, the doctor that came in, you're saying the good, the bad, the things that make you crazy, the differences that you love in each other, and the ones that grate your last nerve, that last good nerve.
That last good
nerve. I love this woman. She never gets on my nerves.
Not Andrea. No, I can't believe that.
No, he's
like you married the perfect woman. You and
him. Yeah, he said it was funny. My dad, when he was with us, we were at a restaurant, my mom and dad, and my mom was getting on this case about eating right, you know?
Yeah.
And she said, no, you shouldn't have that. So he looked at her out of being sarcastic. So, what should I have, Lois, right? And so she went on to tell him, he said, well, praise God. And Pastor McKnight was with him. So Pastor McKnight said, Elder Winans, is that a secret to being married?
Is that a secret to marriage?
He said, yep. Whatever they say, just say praise God. He said, if I would have known that, I would have did it right.
Yeah,
no matter what happens,
that's all I got to know. Praise God.
Yeah, my line is amen.
Amen. Amen. Yes.
Well, that is awesome. Okay, now, she's this traveling lady on the road.
Yeah.
Right.
And I asked Dr. Elaine about this, but how do you balance singing with your brother right. on the road and having the children, and how have you guys made that work?
Balanced it, yeah. Kept it balanced.
In the beginning, it was difficult. Mm-hmm. When the babies were small, it right. was tricky. Mm-hmm. You know, because when I started when they were small, anything to get out of the house, oh, it'll be okay. You'll be fine. Just get someone in here and, you know. So it was an escape, and right. we would do, you know, I would do whatever it took right. to, you know, right. make it work. As time went on, you know, I kind of got my mind right, mm. you know, to the real reason that I'm doing what I'm doing. And I had to include him as opposed mm. to saying, okay, this is a break, this is a vacation for a weekend.
Okay.
And I really had to kind of, you know, take him into consideration and say, you know what? Because in the early days, I would try to find an extra day and say, oh yeah, we're in this beautiful locale. I'm gonna be home yeah. Friday instead of Thursday.
Yeah, spend extra
now, you know, I take him into consideration, and I am in and out so that I could be home and do what I have to do at home, because home is where my heart is, you know? Yeah. Everything else, when I pull the car into the driveway, everything's in my rearview mirror. Nothing else really matters as much as when I'm home and I'm being the wife and the mom that God has called me to be.
That's wonderful.
So you had to learn that, though?
Yes.
It was a process.
Yes.
Well, there's something she's not saying.
Okay. Well, I'm sure you're about to let us know this.
Fill us in.
Okay.
I'm trying to behave, but, you know, it's like being
family.
With family.
Even though we have millions of people watching, we're family.
We're just talking
but
right
you know
here.
What?
Tell
this
me
is,
that, you know, I'm always
deal,
on
though.
The other side of the camera, not on this side, so this is
you know, we know how to stop you, so keep going. No, keep going.
There was a point where, about midway in our marriage,
mm-hmm.
where we were doing all the right things that we're supposed to do.
Mm-hmm.
But there was something started to get routine. Mm-hmm. The love lost its edge a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Not that we didn't love each other.
Right.
But there was something mm-hmm. that made it for her to say, okay, I'm in this great location. I'm gonna spend an extra day. Mm-hmm. Now it's totally different. Now she's texting me and Facebooking me saying, I need to be home. When she lands, she's saying, I already want to be home. And I want her home.
Aww.
And I release her to ministry because I understand the calling on her life.
Mm-hmm.
And I so support that. Mm-hmm. But there was something. She came to me one day and sat me down at a lunch and reached across and said, I love you to pieces,
mm-hmm.
but we're becoming dull and routine.
Dull and routine. Mm.
It's like almost having a roommate. Because mm. I was doing what I was supposed to be doing. I was at that time a producer at an ad agency, and she was doing that, and it
just
was like two
yeah.
ships
yeah.
in
yeah.
the night.
Each other, right.
And we got together, and she told me this, and it kind of blew my mind. It kind of stepped me back, because I'm supplying a house and a roof and food
mm-hmm.
and
yeah.
faithful
the
husband,
thing.
And I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing. But there's a passion and an understanding of considering each other
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
in a relationship
mm-hmm.
that if you do that and you sow that into each other,
mm-hmm.
then you'll reap that of each other.
That's good.
Good.
That's good.
Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatever a man sows. A lot of time we talk about that
yeah.
scripture with
yeah.
money.
Yeah, mm-hmm. right, right.
But if you say, I'm going to care for you mm-hmm. and I'm going to consider you
seeds.
In everything so that I do and
sow
consider,
back into you.
That's what you'll get back.
Ah, that's good.
All of a sudden,
mm-hmm.
passion started sparking back up.
Mm-hmm.
We are more in love today than we were yesterday.
Think just because we're staying married, then that's enough.
It's automatic.
Right. And they think it's just automatic. It automatically
the
happens.
Is
the
there.
Fire yeah. doesn't automatically stay there.
No.
You
Dude,
have to work.
You got to feed
keep,
the flame.
You have
you
to
feed
keep feeding the flame.
Right.
Yeah.
That's true.
Yeah. Alvin, we went to speak for a university
last week.
Last week,
Vanderbilt.
Yeah.
It was a divinity school.
But you said that they said on the average, couples really talk.
That was, yeah, before we did the conference with these young people, mm-hmm. I just got online and started looking at some statistics. And it said that the average couple, and of course, this is what I read, mm-hmm. they said the average couple spends about 35 to 40 minutes a week actually communicating with each other. Not talking at them or hollering, dinner's ready, but actually sitting down and talking to each other. Mm-hmm. 37 minutes
a week.
So
that proves you can be in the house, doing
still,
things.
Yes. Hey, still not right.
And then you wonder why the flame is gone or the compassion or the passion is gone.
Yeah. And you start to get numb. Yeah.
And you start
And that's dangerous.
Yeah, that's true. Dangerous.
Well, you're really taking the situation, like I said, you're taking it for granted.
Yeah.
Because they're in the house, I'm in the house, I'm doing what I'm supposed to do, you're doing what you're supposed to do, everything's supposed to automatically happen.
Yeah. But you have to pour into each other. You have to have that quality time.
Yeah, I mean, and that's kind of what instituted our regular date nights.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's like, you know, when you come home, you know, I've cooked, I've laundried, I've run, chased after babies, and you came home after work, and we're supposed to get together, but you haven't held my hand, you haven't looked at me, you haven't nothing.
Right.
You know,
you
but,
have
you know.
Nothing, you turn to tell
you. See how that works?
But why would guys, that doesn't matter.
Forget about it.
So you have an African American and Italian woman. Oh my
there
God.
There is a house full of passion and animation at my house.
You have a lot of passion in your house.
Now, you're starting to do that? Are you talking with the.
Yeah. She's got the. Bit. She did it, right?
23 years, you know.
And I'm saying, girl, please.
How do you come back on that
one? I get him in the car.
You know what? I'm glad you brought that up, though, because I'm sure I want you to speak to this, too. Interracial marriages. Have you had challenges with that? Because I know we see more of that now.
Yes.
And it's a beautiful thing, because it's a kingdom thing. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So how did you make through some of those challenges?
Would that even... Maybe not be an issue.
I mean, it's...
It's interesting.
First of all,
because I'm 100% Italian. Mm-hmm. There wasn't any other marriages but Italian in my family.
Mm. Oh, until the
so she broke the mold. So she broke the mold, right?
And in her side,
she was on it.
Wow.
Oh, okay. So y'all were first timers. Okay.
Yeah.
To us, here's the thing: we embrace. And find it a blessing for both the cultures. We mm-hmm. celebrate both the cultures. We never saw it in terms of that.
Right,
wow,
of course not.
Right.
But I tell you, other people have.
Right.
It's always the outside.
So if you ask if we've had the problem, we've never had the problem.
Of course not.
Yeah,
but we've encountered people that are like,
yeah.
So what advice do you give? So what advice do you give couples?
See, I didn't have to speak it. I just do the face.
So what advice do you give couples, new married interracial couples? What kind of advice would you give them when it comes to those type of challenges with the outside?
Be secure with each other first. Communication and understanding each other and respecting each other's cultures.
Mm-hmm.
Because there is differences.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And make sure your home... This woman is a defender of the castle.
Mm.
Her thing is, I want peace in my home. That is a theme.
I love that.
If you start there, then you have to remember it's not your problem. It's their problem.
Their problem.
That's good. That's good.
And how do you, when you encounter... What are we supposed to do? Love conquers everything.
Mm-hmm.
Hate takes a long time and a lot of energy to keep going.
Mm-hmm.
Just keep loving on them and keep stepping. Don't let that inside your perimeter. Don't let their problem become your problem.
Mm-hmm.
That's how we've gotten.
I think that's awesome. That's awesome. Well, you know what? I've had such a great time tonight. Are you guys having a great time? So rich. So rich. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you for asking us.
I love you so much.
Yes.
And, but I'm going to ask, why don't we just join hands? And Alvin, would you just pray over the marriages?
Sure.
And then I'll go out with a song, okay?
How much time?
Amen.
Father God, in Jesus' name, we thank you right now, Father God, for the institution of marriage that you instituted, Father God, from the beginning, Father God. And we thank you right now, Father God, for those couples who are watching, who are wondering what is it going to take for them to find the answers. Well, the answer is in Jesus Christ. And Father God, we thank you right now because you have covenant marriages right now. We thank you, Father God, for healing marriages right now.
Yes,
we thank you, Father God, for bringing that man home to that family.
Yes.
We thank you for that woman who can let go and let God take over her mind and her heart. We thank you, Father God, for breaking marriages, but bringing them back together because you are the God who can put back together anything that's been broken. So right now, Father God, we pray a covering right now over marriages. We plead the blood right now over every man and every woman, even over the children, Father God, who are sometimes caught in the middle of situations. We pray, Father God, for healing right now to break forth in the homes in the name of Jesus. Father God, heal right now every marriage, bring to fruition everything that you had called that couple to be in the day that they said, I do. Let that same love they had in the beginning, let it carry them through until the end. And we pray you right now, Father God, because you are the one who is the head of all of us. You are the one who instituted marriage. So we know this is your will for us, Lord, to be married and to stay together. So again, we thank you right now. We praise you, Father, for all that you're doing in our homes. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. We talked a lot about covenant today, and we're going to sing a song entitled, I Promise. Because like he said earlier, Alvin spoke to me. He was just saying, CeCe, what if God decided to leave us? What if he decided to walk out on us? What if he decided that, you know, I just don't want to do this anymore? None of us would be here. Right? It's because of his love, it's because of his grace, it's because of his covenant. How many people are glad that God keeps his promises? He keeps his promises. He is a promise keeper. So we're going to sing this song, I Promise. God bless you. We love you so much. And keep loving one another, all right? You can make it.
Glad you've been with us for Praise the Lord. TBN has a worldwide ministry. We need your love gifts, large or small, to help keep the gospel of Jesus Christ going around the world. So write today, Praise the Lord, P.O. Box A, Santa Ana, California, 92711. Or in Canada, write TBN, P.O. Box 768, Station B, Ottawa, Ontario, K1P 5P8. If you haven't asked Christ into your life, call our prayer partner now and pray to receive Jesus as Savior and Lord. Now, until next time, remember to praise the Lord.
This program has been brought to you through the prayers and contributions of our faithful partners throughout North America and the world.
Imagine a place where you can see the Bible come to life. From the historic land of Israel, through the life of Jesus, to the glory of heaven. Imagine yourself at the Holy Land Experience in Orlando, Florida. Imagine ancient Israel through the wilderness tabernacle, the streets of Jerusalem, and the great temple. Imagine living in the days of David and Bathsheba, one of the Old Testament prophets, or the Apostle Paul. Imagine seeing the transforming power of Jesus come to life in those you've only read about. Imagine being an eyewitness to the life of Jesus, his miracles, his love, his sacrifice, and his final victory. Imagine being in the upper room for communion, then walking through historic and peaceful gardens. Beautiful gardens that encourage contemplation and prayer. Imagine the journey of God's Word through the ages, from tablets to scrolls to the printed press. Imagine the life and work of angels yesterday and today. Imagine being in the ark or the belly of a whale, crossing the Red Sea, or walking on the water with Jesus. Imagine this. And then see us at the Holy Land Experience in Orlando, Florida. Plus, miracle moments, the Jesus Boat, special guest speakers and musicians, and the crystal living waters. In addition to all of this, take a walk through the brand new Christus Gardens. You'll be amazed by the lifelike wax sculptures portraying the biblical accounts in the life of Jesus. Can you imagine it? Then live it. Imagine yourself at TBN's Holy Land Experience in Orlando, Florida,